The Central Bank of Kenya has warned that lack of access to smartphones by half of mobile users in the country could delay the rollout of the proposed digital currency that requires access to the internet. This, according to the governor of the bank, Patrick Njoroge, could delay the rollout, which was initially seen as a game changer in the financial markets of Kenya. Welcome to this week's edition of The Business Show. Now hear stories that made the business week. SMEs tipped on exporting to free trade area countries. Jumia Uganda unveiled Tech Sale Week. Danish government donated equipment to UNBS. And global music market was worth $26 billion in 2021 report.
A social business is one that is created to solve a social problem and also has some additional principles in its management.
When something is done individually, there is a lot of variation. So we train these people. It is easier to train them when they're in groups. But when it is an association also, it gives us actual money to get quantities of these products.
Welcome to the show. Now, for most, the goal of starting a business is usually to make money. But this often overshadows the fact that businesses should be a way to address societal needs. On Views from the Top this week, we speak to Richard Tugume, the Managing Director of UNIS Social Business, who shares with us how they're imparting female-run social businesses with necessary skills to remain relevant.
My names are Richard Tugume Tuliaikayo. I am the country director of UNIS Social Business Foundation Uganda, which is an impact investment fund based out of Berlin in Germany. We have 5 country offices in Brazil, Colombia, Kenya, Uganda, and India. And we were founded 10 years ago. We actually are celebrating our 10-year anniversary this year. We were founded by 2 ladies, one called Saskia Brewston, who works as our global CEO as of now, and a friend of hers called Sophie Eisenman, about 10 years ago. And they founded this organization in partnership with Muhammad Yunus, who is a Nobel Peace Prize laureate of 2006. And founder of the microfinance philosophy. So a social business, as defined by our founder, is one that is created to solve a social problem and also has some additional principles in its management. Some of which are the fact that it must be paying fair wages to its employees. It must not be strictly for profit maximization. And so the whole philosophy of social business was designed to mitigate the excesses of capitalism, as it were, the maximization of profit is done at all costs and with several negative ramifications, like driving wages down, creating all sorts of environmental challenges in the production process. So it's a business, it's a philosophy that thinks about business being done with a conscience. First thing is that we create a baseline before we intervene, and that baseline is in regards to social impact parameters. So they can be as various as number of jobs, both direct and indirect, that the business so far has created before we intervene. It could be on the area of incomes that suppliers for that business are actually getting as a direct intervention of the business. And so when we intervene with typically the working capital and CAPEX loans that we provide and technical assistance, we then begin taking a check at periodical intervals, quarterly, monthly, depending on the nature of business, to see how those impact metrics are actually now playing out post-intervention. And so the success of a social business is measured upon progress on those particular metrics, like number of jobs created, whether incomes are rising of their suppliers, typical smallholder suppliers in our business sector, and then that defines the degree or the level of success for this particular social business we're talking about. So far we have supported about 24 social businesses and counting in the various sectors of agribusiness, health, education, renewable energy, water and sanitation as well, and counting. And for example, even this year we are on schedule to onboard an additional 8 that would take us to about 32. I'll talk about the summary and the core elements that we look at, what we call the deal breakers. One is that the company must already be either at break-even or its business plan shows that our intervention will make it break-even, right? And break-even really is that it's at loss, it's not losing money from its normal operations at the end of the financial year. That's the key thing. Number two is that it must have existed for at least 3 years. And the key reason for that is that in 3 years' time, the entrepreneur would have de-risked the business to a point where it can now be grown and scaled, and the learning curve has severely been mitigated. And number three is that the entrepreneur and the top management team of the company must be of good values. And more specifically is that they must have no negative reputation in terms of their history of borrowing funds, you know, from any other organizations they have dealt with before, the idea of how they run their business, how they deal with their stakeholders like customers and suppliers. They must have no, you know, negative reputation in the industry. Those are our three key criteria that we consider, in addition to several other secondary ones. YSB has a particular soft spot for women entrepreneurs because we also understand that the uplifting of women is a big part of mitigating what we call wealth concentration by gender. And so wherever they have existed, we have tried to support them. Currently, in our portfolio, we have two are women-owned and women-run, and one is simply women-run business. And we have helped in a manner where we provide them the loans they need, structure them appropriately, support them with technical assistance, support them with the soft skills and values training to help them understand the whole concept of social business and, you know, thinking about the wider ecosystem rather than their selfish selves. And so yes, we are on course to continue doing the same thing, mindful of the fact that helping women is a much bigger social, is much more socially impactful than helping the men who are already dominant in most of these sectors. Yeah, so we have three of them now. The first one is called Cycle Connect, based out of Gulu and Lira in northern Uganda. These guys have a business that is based on a lease-to-own model of a number of items or assets. And this includes things like grinding mills, things like motorcycles, ox plow equipment and things like that, and they've been doing well to help empower women and even men to some extent in their localities. The second one is called Eastern Agriculture Development Company, based out of Eastern Uganda. They do what is called pre-cooked beans, where they are not even just ordinary beans, but they are beans that are highly rich in iron and are helping solve the challenge of malnutrition in their area, and also paying fairly good prices to their farmer suppliers who are working on a contract farming basis in that area, part of the country. Also woman-led, woman-owned. And the third one we have is called Achila Enterprises, also based in Eastern Uganda. And for them, they are into grain growing and processing, where they have a number of outgrower farmers that supply to their plant. And they have a number of off-taker contracts where they are able to get good prices by processing and selling a good and consistent product that then they are able to pass on, you know, defined, definite and good prices to their smallholder farmers. And so yes, there are three exemplary businesses that we are proud of in the portfolio. The challenge of poverty. Poverty alleviation is like a cross-cutting theme for all three. And this one is based on mainly smallholder farmers in these rural areas that for a long time have been exploited and continue to be exploited by middlemen and loan sharks who give them, you know, loans at a very astronomical interest rates at the off season, and they take this crop for nothing during the harvest. Or middlemen who come knocking on their doors at night and are offering very low prices in cash, or buying them with tampered, with weighing scales that have been tampered with to read incorrect weights. So that's by far the biggest. The second one they are also trying to solve, in one particular case, is the issue of malnutrition, where a deficiency of protein is causing kwashiorkor, which ultimately causes stunted growth, which ultimately leads into poor mental performance, be it academic or otherwise, and then continues the vicious cycle of poverty in these communities. And then another one, in the case of Cycle Connect in Gulu Lira, is also providing an element of helping these communities diversify their incomes, where you have a farming community able to do some other side business, like the grinding mills or a motorcycle that will do the border business, and earn a daily or weekly income that helps them bridge the gaps when the harvest is not on, and allow the community to be able to thrive in a manner that they would not have done without them. The changes we've realized are quite a number. I would segregate them into two major categories. There's the quantitative and the qualitative. On the quantitative aspect, we have changes in the metrics like improved incomes that these guys are earning, particularly suppliers like smallholder farmers. We have metrics like increased number of jobs, both direct and indirect, that these entities are creating. And then the qualitative aspect, we have aspects like reduced crime in these communities, because once these people are idle and disorderly because they have no job to do, they are forced to indulge into other social vices, which include crime, taking of drugs, involvement into other particularly non-economic activities that are very negative to the community. That's one aspect. The other one is that once they take on these jobs, they are able to increase their self-esteem and dignity. It also has, in many cases, improved family relations, you know, between parents and children and all the things, because their parents are now more gainfully employed. And so, yes, it's a combination of several things that ultimately are helping us improve the welfare of hundreds and thousands of people, and also ultimately mitigate what I initially called the excesses of capitalism that is based on a maximization of profit without caring about the ramifications of that endeavor. The investment in social business for anyone that had the means to is not only important in the sense that the promotion of social business is what will ultimately sustain what I would call the global order. Social business is what will ultimately stabilize the world economically, socially, politically, and otherwise. And why I say this is that if that does not happen, and that I mean the promotion of social business in a manner that is done at scale, you will end up having an unsustainable point where you have the biggest segment of the world population having no stake at what is available. And so the risk there is that these masses of people will be better served by creating chaos where they have a chance to shake up the system and get what they don't have now, rather than cooperate and remain in a system that is stable for a few and where they are surely going to die early and having achieved nothing. And so social business is the only way in which the haves are able to be more inclusive, to bring the have-nots on board in a manner that allows everyone else to enjoy a decent level of sustainable prosperity.
Well, I hope you remember the next time you venture into business that you'll be needing to address some society issues and involving some members of your community into what you are doing. We shall be taking a break, but if you're watching for the first time, welcome to The Business Show, and you can always catch our episodes on YouTube, hashtag The Business Show, and the show itself airs every Thursday, 10 p.m. Thanks again. We take a break, but we shall return shortly. Stay tuned.